Hello everyone and welcome to my channel where we talk about everything grad life, grad advice, and research. In today's video, I am highlighting the 5 biggest mistakes I made as a graduate student trying to fund my PhD. So if you want to avoid these huge mistakes and figure out how to be best prepared to fund your PhD, then stay tuned. For as long as I can remember, my parents had always encouraged me to become a graduate student. And by a very young age, it was my dream to be a PhD student. And while my parents did graduate from undergrad, they had never been to grad school. And by that time in our lives, we didn't really know anybody who went to grad school. So it's understandable that there was a lot that I didn't know. In fact, I vividly remember them telling me that once you get accepted into a PhD program, that they will pay for all of your tuition, your housing, your food, and your living expenses. And maybe that was the reality back in the 1980s when they were in college, but it's definitely not the case now. But I didn't know that. So you can imagine how excited I was when I got accepted into a PhD program at UCLA. Not to mention, I had been rejected from every other school that I applied to 2 years in a row. And this leads to mistake number one. I accepted my offer from UCLA without really understanding what was a financial package and what did my financial package consist of. A graduate funding package is sort of like a contract between the university and the student that they're trying to recruit. Once a university is done making all of its offers, then it goes around and offers how much money or financial support they can provide. And within a financial package, there could be many different ways that the university is helping you pay for school. This could be stipends or grants, which many of us are most familiar with and understand. There's also working positions like being a teaching assistant or being a graduate student researcher, a TA in a GSR. These are jobs that graduate students can hold, but oftentimes some of the benefits that come with these positions is that it covers tuition and then also pays you on top of that. Because I genuinely thought once you were accepted into a grad program that they would automatically cover your expenses and tuition, and after being rejected for so many years, I had a little bit of self-doubt and fear that maybe they would take it away, I accepted it almost immediately. But this ended up being one of the biggest mistakes I could have made. When I received my funding package, I had no financial support. That's no TA-ships, no GSRs, no grants, and no stipends. I was basically left on my own to figure out how to move from Philadelphia to Los Angeles, pay for rent, secure an apartment, pay for food, pay for healthcare, tuition, my books, gas, and not to mention other things like student parking. And this is why I encourage you to be patient and wait to see your funding package before you accept your offer. Once you know what your financial package is, then the next step is to really reflect how much money do you need to live and thrive as a graduate student. So this would include the essentials like housing, childcare, food, utilities, but also things you may not have really realized before, like books, parking at the university, and I would really include all of the essentials and things that are most important to you to live a comfortable and safe life. This number is what you use to reference how much do you need your university to give you. And if what you need to live comfortably as a graduate student doesn't match with the amount that they've given you for your financial package, then you need to negotiate. And this is something that I didn't know. And even if I did know, because I only had one offer, I'm not sure I would have had the confidence to do it. But I'm telling you, even if you only have one offer, it is so important that you negotiate your funding package to make sure that they provide the support you need and deserve. And this leads to mistake number two. I didn't advocate for myself or my financial needs. I approached graduate school and graduate funding with a deficit mindset, that I was just happy to be there. So I felt really guilty about asking for money that I needed to survive. It is so important that you negotiate and advocate for yourself, even if it's your only offer. But again, I didn't really know that. So what did I do? I panicked. And I sent a pretty obviously distressed email to the chair and grad advisor of the department. And basically in this email, I kind of laid out all of my concerns and I explained to them I just wasn't sure how I was gonna be able to be a graduate student or even make it to Los Angeles without any support from my department. Now, this doesn't necessarily count as negotiating because I didn't really know what I was doing. I didn't have a goal. I just wanted them to help me out in some way. And after this email, about a month before school, they found me about $11,500 roughly. I went from zero to 11,000 and I felt very grateful at the time. But now, 3 years in, I have a completely different perspective. If we really break down how much money my department gave me, $11,500 for an entire year, divide that by 12, that's about $958 a month. So even though it felt like a lot of money, the reality was it was really just crumbs, and there was no way I could have survived a year off of $11,500. And so this is my message to all of you. You deserve to be in grad school. You have every right to pursue your education and become a doctor. You are enough, and you don't deserve to have to spend that time as a graduate student worried about how are you going to eat, where are you going to live, or how are you going to turn on the light so you can do your homework. And what helped me is really reframing how I think about being a graduate student and think of it less as being a student like when I was in undergrad and more looking at it as I am doing a job. I am a researcher that is producing knowledge, which in turn supports the department, which builds the credibility of the university, and thus I have value and I should be compensated accurately. You as a graduate student produce so much for the university. You teach students, you help faculty, you do your original research, which gets published under their name and helps push up their clout. So you should never undersell yourself and you should never feel guilty for wanting more. Not having financial stability affects so many parts of your life. It affects your mental health, your physical health, and ultimately your academic health. So advocating for yourself should not be seen as something selfish. It's a necessary step for you to have a healthy and sustainable graduate experience. But not having this understanding is what actually led to mistake number three. And that was, I started looking for a ton of jobs to supplement the money that I wasn't receiving from my graduate department. I did what I always knew to do. Hustle. And I ended up getting a ton of jobs as a first year graduate student. Now, for a lot of us like me, this is a necessity because we don't really know how to fund our graduate program. So we fund it in the way that we know, getting a job. But I was working 10 hours a week with financial wellness program. Then I was working 20 hours a week as a teaching assistant in multiple departments throughout the year. So 30 hours of my academic work week was filled with working outside of my own research. And while financially it was really advantageous to have two jobs as a first year student and work 75%, what I was doing wasn't necessarily sustainable. And while you can make it work, it's really unfair, especially to marginalized students who are first generation and don't know anything about graduate school. And so for me, I learned that looking for multiple jobs as a graduate student should actually be a second to last resort, which leads to my fourth mistake. What should be your last resort? Student loans. As a student worker, I was able to make enough money to pay my in-state tuition and my daily monthly essentials like utilities, rent, groceries, but I still had out-of-state tuition that I had to pay for, and I didn't fully understand that the TA-ship didn't cover that. So I did something that I really didn't expect that I would have to do as a graduate student, and I took out federal loans. Now, if you want a video talking about pros and cons of federal loans and just general understanding of what they are and how they work, leave a comment below so I can start preparing for it. But essentially, I had to take out student loans for the 30th billionth time in my life, and I felt really dejected and almost like a complete failure because I couldn't afford to go to grad school. So as a very last resort, I took out a student loan. And the reason I called this a mistake, even though it was really unavoidable for me, is because with proper planning, I could have been prepared to cover the last bit of money that was required for me to be able to pay for my graduate education. I mean, sometimes it's a necessary evil, but the reality is there might be another way. And I didn't take the time to really think through what are my options to cover the $6,000, $7,000 deficit that I had for my out-of-state tuition. So I would highly advise, if you can avoid them, to avoid them. But if you can't, it's okay. You will be able to make it out. And there are steps and processes and programs to help you do that. But all of these mistakes have one common denominator. And that's the biggest mistake I've made as a graduate student when trying to fund my PhD. Which leads us to mistake number 5. Depending solely on my university or my department to fund my PhD. I highly encourage that while you are applying to graduate schools, you are also simultaneously applying to grants and scholarships to fund your education. During my entire first year, every opportunity that I looked for was at UCLA. All of the jobs that I had pursued were on-campus jobs, but I could have took my skill set to a variety of different institutions or organizations that may have paid me more. Not to mention, if you already have a master's, you can apply to a community college to be an adjunct or a lecturer there. Though you may not know where to start, it's really important to look outside of your university and your department for support. Apply to outside granting agencies, no matter how small or how large they are. Look for jobs and positions outside of your campus limit and put yourself first and beat the system. Your ultimate goal should be making it out of the program with your degree, mental health, and financial stability. So don't be afraid to put yourself first and really do what is best for you. Funding, and actually grad school more generally, is a really interesting, confusing, exciting, but also frightening time. So if you're interested in exploring more grad life, hearing more grad advice, and learning everything research, hit the subscribe button. And if you found at least 2 things valuable, hit the thumbs up so people know that this video has good quality content. And if there are any questions that I didn't answer, drop them in the comments below so I can make sure I include them in future videos. Thank you so much for watching. See you next week.